Hi guys, Janus here. Welcome back. As promised, today I'd like to explain how and why the angion method is so effective for not only beating erectile dysfunction, but putting on serious size below the belt. In today's video, I'm going to be revealing some previously little-known structures inside blood vessels that is absolutely crucial to the angion method's success. The first drawing I'd like to discuss is of a blood vessel cross-section people are fairly familiar with. It's in a lot of anatomy textbooks or similar educational sources. For most of us, this is what we may very well believe the inside of a blood vessel looks like. We've got layers of connective tissue, elastin and collagen right here. We've got layers of smooth muscle right here. We've got the outer longitudinal layer, and then we've got the inner circumferential layers. And then right in through here, we've got the endothelial cells and a nice little cluster of red blood cells. As stated, this is very commonplace. It's very well known. It's also laughably incomplete. What I'd like to show you next is a much more accurate representation of what a blood vessel cross-section should look like. The three biggest differences you might notice are all of these small holes throughout the vascular wall, along with these tubes right here. And then, of course, these green hairs. Before I talk about the middle portion here, I'd like to take some time to explain a concept many might not be familiar with regarding blood vessels, which will be relevant later in the video and future releases. As we saw with the first blood vessel cross-section, these black-colored structures were mysteriously not shown, despite their enormous presence, obviously, in the blood vessel wall. For whatever reason, many anatomy textbook publishers have purposely decided to opt for a more simplistic model despite causing gross misunderstandings about the true nature of many diseases and blood vessels themselves. Even commercials pushed out by drug companies avoid this more accurate model. At first, I believed it might be due to the structures being a fairly new discovery, yet I was finding routine mention of them as far back as the 80s. Something wasn't adding up that repeatedly made me feel deeply uneasy. Why would the ivory towers of education purposely misrepresent something that is so crucial to our health and continue to do so for decades? As I continued to study more accurate blood vessel models like the one behind me here, I came to understand exactly how dangerous many different types of foods actually were for my health and why some forms of medication are in reality downright terrifying. You see, ladies and gentlemen, blood does not just pass through the middle portion of a blood vessel. It passes through their very walls by means of a highly abundant bed of capillaries, as we see here. This system of capillaries is the very means by which all tissues are sustained, including blood vessels. Though anatomy textbooks and 3D model designers love portraying blood vessels as these crisp, uniform constructs for the sake of simplicity, like the first model I showed you, an actual blood vessel looks more like a bushy mass of tissue that snakes its way through the body, as I'm sure you could take a guess at looking here. Healthy blood vessels are awash with these collateral vessels that penetrate the surrounding tissues and then branch out further and further until they finally form capillary beds made of monolayers of endothelial cells. Saying all of this, why exactly does this happen? Why do blood vessels look like a bushy mass? The answer comes down to two strange bedfellows, which are more than a little easy to overlook, and yet are responsible for all of this. A handful of years ago, I had a fateful encounter with a particularly disheveled tome that was soon to be tossed out during a library renovation. To this day, I'm completely uncertain what the name of the book was, much less its author. I was only able to salvage a small portion of a 1,000-plus-page book that had been completely torn apart and was about to be tossed into the dumpster. In those few pages I was able to salvage, a researcher described odd protrusions which extended in the blood vessel's main channel. He aptly called it an internal shag carpet. At the time, I had no idea what to make of this unknown author's claim or the massive impact it would have on my life later on. On that fateful day, all of those years ago, I had my very first introduction to a mysterious structure known as the glycocalyx. The glycocalyx, this shag carpet, renews itself throughout a person's life and serves as an important type of sensor which can sense changes in the rate of blood flow, among other things. After more reading than I care to mention, I came to understand that these little structures have a very intimate relationship with endothelial cells. Wherever endothelial cells can be found, so too can the glycocalyx. At this time, I'm genuinely uncertain if the glycocalyx is an entirely separate cell strata or if it's a part of endothelial cells. In either case, the outcome is still the same. Whenever the glycocalyx, the shag carpet I mentioned previously, mechanically senses a drop in the rate of blood flow in a given area, it signals the endothelial cells to begin producing vasoconstricting factors, along with downregulating the production of NO synthase, a chemical responsible for converting arginine into nitric oxide. Conversely, whenever the glycocalyx mechanically senses an increase in the rate of blood flow in a given area, the shag carpet essentially being pushed over, notice the diagonal slant, signals endothelial cells to begin rapidly producing NO synthase. Literally within seconds of sensing this, a blood vessel begins to relax and therefore dilate. The force the glycocalyx is specifically responding to is referred to as shear stress. Shear stress is a force which causes drag along the internal surfaces of all blood vessels. This force occurs constantly as the heart circulates blood. Due to the highly stimulating nature of shear stress, blood vessels have adapted to rapidly respond to any and all changes in this force. One of those adaptations is the linchpin to the Angion method's success. Whenever shear stress is chronically elevated through a given portion of the vascular tree, endothelial cells begin overproducing nitric oxide to kickstart an absolutely fascinating event. They burrow. Endothelial cells form into needle-like spirals and then begin literally burrowing into the blood vessel walls and eventually into the surrounding tissues. Allow me to show you an example of how that starts. Notice how the cells have begun to spiral around a central point. This is the beginning of that needle structure I was just telling you about. What's more, they begin producing even more endothelial cells, which bury themselves deeper and deeper, further and further, until eventually this needle-like structure connects to venous outlets. Since this occurs in mass, it eventually results in an outward growth of blood vessels. Basically, shear stress causes a blood vessel to all but permanently increase its inner diameter and overall structure with time. But there's even more to this story. I can think of no other way to describe it, other than endothelial cells and the glycocalyx seem to thrive on, if not love, shear stress. Initially, I thought shear stress would be greater in the larger blood vessels, but in reality, the amount of shear stress which a capillary bed undergoes is, in a word, insane. It's nothing for the amount of shear stress inside a capillary to be 4 or even 5-fold greater than it would be in a larger blood vessel. This design is something I still find myself marveling at from time to time. Given the fact that endothelial cells arrange themselves according to shear stress and then grow by merit of the very same force, it's for this reason we're capable of healing. More than just healing, it's how we grow. Allow me to recap. We know that endothelial cells respond to shear stress by producing nitric oxide. We know that with chronic stimulation by shear stress, endothelial cells eventually form spirals which bore outwardly in all directions. Lastly, we know that endothelial cells arrange themselves according to shear stress. Between these three adaptive responses, I came to discover that capillary beds almost cannot help but form. After I really came to understand this awe-inspiring phenomenon, I was driven to figure out just how much endothelial cells could spur a tissue to grow. I found part of my answer studying cancer. Cancer. It's a word that for many echoes like a death toll when said aloud. It's ironic that the very means by which cancer is even possible is the very means by which a child eventually becomes an adult. And that is capillary bed formation by endothelial cells. Regretfully, since many companies all over the world are scrambling to invent a cure for cancer, I eventually had to scrap this area of study simply due to a sheer lack of helpful research. For months, I floundered about, making almost no headway until one day, I stumbled across a book on marine biology and fin regeneration. Researchers quickly picked up on the fact that endothelial cells may be the very means by which an animal regenerates various parts of its body. To better understand just how much regeneration relied on endothelial cell growth, researchers began playing around with various levels of growth factors in a variety of fish. Quite quickly, they found that even marginally impairing endothelial cell replication caused stunted regeneration. It was right about then that I realized I hit pay dirt, and the Angion method was born. There were, however, a few questions I still needed to answer. First was how I could ramp up shear stress in the male phallus. Secondly, how I could ramp up the amount of growth factors my body naturally produced. And thirdly, whether or not there were pre-existing structures inside the body that took advantage of everything I was studying. Really considering the first question, I figured my first task should be to begin looking as closely as possible at the microstructures in the body, maybe even natural formations. Since I was already committed to finding a way to grow the male phallus, I figured I'd start my search there. On the whole, I was fairly familiar with the male phallus on a macro level, but some of the more minute intricacies escaped me. My initial idea was to call a local meat shop and ask if they had any leftover sexual organs from a recent slaughter. But I knew that this could also cause all manner of difficulties and be quite expensive, so I decided to save that as my ace in the hole. Despite that, for a long while, I thought I'd be forced to turn my kitchen into a biolab. My saving grace came in the form of ultrasound research. After digging through countless images, I found a few choice morsels that helped me answer the first question about pre-existing structures. Inside the male phallus, blood vessels arrange themselves in a manner perfectly suited to take advantage of shear stress. They form into tight spirals. In my brief stint as an engineering student, I remember learning that water pipes work best when they're arranged in a linear fashion. All bends are subject to suspicion because they typically become weak very easily and have an undue amount of internal friction. My suspicions were officially confirmed about the male phallus being designed to maximize shear stress in order to get as much growth as possible. The only two questions left for me to answer was how I could ramp up shear stress and boost my body's production of natural growth factors. By this point, I was already up to my eyeballs in medical textbooks, so I thought I'd peruse some more to see if I could find anything that really stuck out. After exhausting my usual haunts, I figured I'd thumb through my surgery manuals. The very first thing many authors point out is that the vast majority of arteries penetrate central masses of tissue clusters, leaving veins more exposed along the outer perimeter. I had a novel idea, but I wouldn't really know if it was going to work until I took a bit of a closer look at how blood vessels of the male phallus were arranged. Sure enough, the veins ran along the outside of the shaft, leaving them exposed to external forces. The only thing left was to do a little bit of experimentation. Those experiments came to lay the foundation for what the Angion method is today. During my initial experiments with various different types of techniques, I would constantly lose my erections. This was admittedly pretty disheartening, but I knew that my research was sound, so it was just back to the drawing board for a little while. I spent the vast majority of my time doing things like fact-checking, checking over my previous notes, and really, really studying anatomical models. It was during my second round of experimentation that everything really started changing, and that was when I came to develop burst expansion and pyramid rush. After regular applications of those two, I knew I'd come across something really, really special. But I really wanted to know exactly how special. So, taking a lesson from bodybuilding, I knew that growth required an excess amount of calories. Towards that end, on a daily basis, I tried consuming somewhere between 3 to 3,500 calories. So 3,000 calories to about 3,500. I wanted to get right there in that neat little window. Initially, the only thing I really noticed was a marked increase in my erectile health. Right about the 2-week mark, though, something really cool started happening. A month and a half later, obviously, I took my after photo, and the rest is history. Alright, for those of you that hung on for the whole video, because yes, I know it's long, big thumbs up to you. In my next video, I'm going to tackle the second question that needed to be answered, and that was how I could ramp up the natural growth factors in my body to really maximize blood vessel growth. In that video, I'm going to cover various foods I found which are actually very beneficial to blood vessel growth, and others that are not so much. Just a heads up, that one's going to be pretty controversial. If you haven't liked and subscribed, go ahead and hit those buttons now. Barring any odd complications, I'm going to try to pump out videos about once every 2 weeks. Lastly, thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you next time.